Blackstone Publishing presents Knocked for a Loop by Craig Rice. This book is read by Johnny Heller. Chapter 1. Something unpleasant was going to happen. Something incredibly and overwhelmingly unpleasant. John J. Malone was sure of it. This conviction had not come to him by instinct or during a quick conference with a crystal ball. He knew it, by the way. The owner, manager, and bartender of Joe the Angel's City Hall Bar was gazing at him, solicitously. Indeed, Joe the Angel had just bought him two drinks in rapid succession, and that clinched it. "If this is just a bad dream," the little lawyer said gloomily, "I wish I could tune in on another channel." "Malone," Joe the Angel said in a worried voice, "maybe it would be better that you don't go." Malone shook his head. The impending appointment in his office was one that he had to keep, in spite of his friend's gloomy predictions and his own uncomfortable premonitions. It might solve a kidnapping. It might prevent a murder. It might settle a lot of questions, many of them political and all of them complicated and disagreeable. Furthermore, it might even make money for John J. Malone. He looked up at the clock over the bar. It was still early, but for once in his life he wanted to leave the pleasant shelter of Joe the Angel's. It wasn't that he was looking forward to the next hour or two, but Joe the Angel's reaction to his having been picked as the go-between and the Commande affair had unnerved him. In fact, the whole situation had unnerved him. He was used to walking into trouble and to knowing that it was going to be there waiting for him. But he did like to know in advance what particular kind of trouble it was going to be. He sighed unhappily, finished his rye, and went out into the night that was heady with warm spring winds, whispering of far more agreeable activities than keeping a business appointment. The mellow fights of neon signs made a nice substitute for technicolor moonlight, and the sounds in a loudspeaker of a nearby phonograph shop could have been the music of the spheres. But not for Malone, not that night. Moonlight and this particular business appointment wouldn't mix. It was 10:05, and the appointment was set for 10:30. Malone decided to go on up to his office and do his worrying in private. For just a moment, he paused and stood looking from across the street at the somewhat dingy and far from pretentious building that had housed his office since the time he'd finished night law school, passed his bar examinations, and given up driving a taxi, more years ago than he cared to remember. On a sudden and completely unreasonable impulse, one that he was never able to explain later, even when it became important, he went down the alley, unlocked a rear door, and made his way up to his office floor on the self-service freight elevator. The hallway was not only dark and deserted, but downright melancholy. Almost ominous. Malone lit a cigar, gave himself a brief but very stern talking to, opened the door and switched on the light. Then for a moment he stood silent, his cigar going out unnoticed. Something like this had been bound to happen sooner or later. The amazing thing was that it had not happened before. Malone looked down at the body of Leonard Estapole, at the carefully planted signs of a mild struggle, and reflected that whoever had framed him for murder had done an excellent job. But his private guardian angel had done an excellent job, too, in getting him here a good 15 minutes early, because this was one of the times when he was going to have to act fast and think about what to do after he had done it. Leonard Estapole, financier, solid citizen, and sterling character, anti-crime crusader, and committee member, had appointed himself a one-man anti-Malone committee as well. Now he lay sprawled on the floor of John J. Malone's private office, bludgeoned to death with the conventional blunt instrument, in this case a heavy bronze Buddha from Malone's desk. Leonard Estapole had been a tall, skinny, ascetic-looking man with skimpy pale hair, eyes like ice-blue eggs, long, squeamish nose, and a thin, almost lipless mouth that had smiled only at park dedications and cornerstone-laying ceremonies. He didn't look any better dead, either. But this was no time to think about the murdered man's lack of charm, Malone reflected. The immediate problem was what to do with him for the next few hours. The little lawyer looked around the room thoughtfully. Moving the late Leonard Estapole was going to be a heavy job, but not impossible, and the fire escape seemed to be the best and simplest solution. He opened the window and hauled the body through it and down to the next landing. He tucked it carefully in the narrow space between the fire stairs and the window pane so it wouldn't be noticed by a casual glance from above. Then he climbed back to his office, puffing, and reflecting that it was a damn good thing Leonard Estapole hadn't been a bigger man. That done, he set himself to a fast job of straightening up the office. He righted the two overturned chairs and the wastebasket. He picked up the bronze Buddha and put it exactly where it had always been on the desk. It was probably thick with fingerprints, but he wasn't in the least...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.